with my love and respects. Today's subject is quantum spirituality. First, let us understand the word quantum. Then we will really be able to understand what I mean by the word quantum spirituality. This word quantum has become very popular in the recent modern days. In every field, not only in the physics, in every field the quantum word has become very popular. Earlier, physicists are telling matter is energy. Whatever you see as matter is nothing but energy. There is no difference between matter and energy. After some time, they started telling the same particle at some time exists as matter and exists as energy. Sometime the same particle expresses itself as matter, the next moment the same particle expresses itself as energy. After some time, they start telling there is no time gap. The same, at the same moment, it is energy and matter. Now recently they say, not only there is no time gap, there is no space gap. Of course, the ideas which I am expressing needs your attention. The truth which I am expressing is very deep. It can transform your whole life. It can change the whole way of thinking, your mental setup. This moment, it can liberate you. Scientists are telling earlier the matter and energy are not two different things. Next, they come up to a level. Energy and matter are only different thing in different time. The same particle, at this moment it's energy, the next moment it is matter. After some time, they start telling there is no difference. The time gap doesn't exist. It's not like 50-50. For few moments it is matter and few moments it is energy. No. Let me give you a small story that may give you an understanding. One meat shop owner was brought to the court. Customers were complaining about him. He is mixing too much of beef into the chicken. Meat shop owner is giving an explanation. Sir, in my shop board itself it is very clearly written, I mix 50-50. Judge said, I understand you say 50-50, but after tasting your meat, I don't believe it is 50-50. I did not experience the taste of chicken in that. I felt it is purely beef. The owner said, no sir, honestly I tell you, I do only 50-50. One chicken, one cow. The words, if you don't understand, you will completely miss the truth. Of course, words cannot give you the complete experience, but it can take you to the point From where you can take the jump into experience. Now the words which I am uttering are the words which I am sharing. Directly they may not give you the experience, but if you allow these words to work on you, it can take you to the point from where you can jump into the experience. You can go beyond the words. Matter and energy are not two different things. There is no time gap. At every moment, the same particle is matter and energy. The reason is, the scientists are saying, not only there is no time gap, there is no space gap. This is too much. They say, whatever you are seeing is not as you think. If you are seeing me, they say, I am not as you understand. And if you are seeing your neighbor, they say, he or she is not as you understand. If you are seeing the chair, they say it doesn't exist as you understand it. It's a truth which shakes your whole understanding. It just moves the very understanding. Whatever you think or whatever way you understand the world, scientists are saying it is not the truth. The truth is something higher. Just how the quantum physicists say, matter and energy are one and the same. I experienced the spiritual and material life are one and the same. As on now, constantly we have a struggle between our head and heart, material life and spiritual life. The lifestyle which is imposed, forced on us by our school, college, universities, and the lifestyle which is the truth or which really our heart wants to live. These two are pulling us apart. The logic is pulling us towards one direction and the heart is taking us towards the other direction. Constantly we are torn, we are disturbed between these two kind of lifestyle. We are trying to choose. If I have to say, the frequently asked question, again and again and again, I am asked by people, Swamiji, how to reconcile between this spiritual life and material life? Please be very clear, the very doubt, the spiritual life and material life exists because you have an idea about life. It is your mind in which both the concept exists. Material life means the life of logic. Whatever you think as life, life taught to you by your university, schools, colleges, the life of achievement. What next? What next? What next? Next. Spiritual life is like a vertical line. Material life is like a horizontal line. What next? What next? What next? Based on your logic. Spiritual life is like a vertical line. You just fly. Spiritual life is based on the intuition. Material life is based on the logic. The big problem is, always there is a conflict between this intuition and logic. What you want and what society wants from you. what you want and what society wants from you. These two wants constantly fight with each other. You are being pulled and pushed from this side to that side. One side, your logic is constantly pulling you. The other side, the heart is constantly asking you to live the life which you wanted to live. As long as you believe, you can travel only in one direction. Your life will be hell. Your life will be hell. Be very clear. As long as you believe, you have to choose either spiritual life or material life. Your life will be hell. Because any choice, choosing means you exclude something, you avoid something. The moment you try to avoid something, one thing is sure, it will again and again come into your being. Just try to avoid remembering monkey. Constantly you will be meditating on monkey. Person who tries to avoid remembering something will be constantly thinking about the same thing. The moment you exclude something, you already created hell for you. You already created trouble for you. The moment you start choosing, you created suffering for you. Bliss is choicelessness. When you are choiceless, you are in ecstasy. When you are choiceless, you are in bliss. The moment you start choosing, you have created hell for you. You have created hell for you. People again and again ask me, Swamiji, how to retain the bliss? I tell them, the moment you choose bliss, you created pain for you. Even choosing bliss is a choice. Bliss happens to you as choicelessness. When you are in choicelessness, when you are utterly relaxed, when you are completely relaxed, when you are in choiceless consciousness, bliss happens to you. It's like when you put your hand in the river, if your hands are open, you will have the water. The moment you lift your hand and try to hold the water, you will have only empty hands. The moment you try to hold the bliss, you will create hell for you. Any choice, the moment you try to decide, the moment you try to choose, you are creating hell for you. Small story. American young guy went to London, was traveling in a train with an elderly lady and gentleman. The lady had a pet dog. Suddenly the pet jumped on him, on this guy, and messed up the whole thing. Instead of apologizing, that lady started petting the dog. Oh, I think you are having a bad stomach, you are having a problem. She did not bother to apologize. She started petting the dog. After 10 minutes, again the dog jumped and vomited on him. Again this lady, she didn't bother to apologize. She started talking to the dog. Oh, I should take you to the doctor. I think I should give you a little medicine. She started taking care of the dog. After 10 minutes, again the dog jumped on him. Now it is too much. This guy simply picked up the dog and threw out of the window. Till this moment, the elderly gentleman was keeping quiet. Now he got up and started shouting, "You Americans drive in the wrong side, measure with the wrong scale, talk in the wrong way. Now you threw the wrong person out of the window." when you choose, you always take a wrong decision. Any choice, the moment you are forced to choose, you are in trouble, you are in dilemma. Mind exists as long as you have dilemma. Please be very clear, the root of the mind is nothing but dilemma. If you have a conflict, if you have the problem of whether spiritual life or material life, be very clear, you are living a material life. If you have a doubt, am I living spiritual life or material life? Be very clear, today you can drop the doubt, you are living a material life. The doubt or the dilemma, conflict, all these things clearly show you are in hell. You are in hell. Somebody asked me, Swamiji, people say that marriages are decided in heaven. Is it true? I tell them, I don't know whether it is decided in heaven or not. But after that, people live in hell. That much I know. After that, people live in hell. If you have to decide, the very dilemma is nothing but hell. Your mind is trying its best to choose between the horizontal line and the vertical line. At one moment, you are trying to travel in vertical line. At some time, you are trying to move in the horizontal line. Your head, your logic, whatever is taught to you in the school, college, that forces you to travel in horizontal line, materialistic life. But your heart is moving in a different direction. It always wants to rest, relax. That is why you have conflict between your work and vacation. Continuously, you have conflict between your work and vacation. When you are in the work, you are thinking about your vacation. When you are lying in the beach, you are thinking about your work. What has to be done next? One thing is sure, if you are here, you are not here. If you are here physically, mentally you will be doing something else. If you are somewhere physically, mentally you will be doing something else. I always tell people, people are not sitting in front of me physically, they are more connected to me, because mentally they always remember me. I could have gone to the lecture, I should have gone to the program, I think I missed it. People are sitting physically, I think I could have gone to some other program, I could have been sitting and watching movie, or I could have done that. Anyhow, you have come, let us sit. The mind always moves between extremes. Be very clear, your mind cannot survive if it doesn't move from extremes. The very survival of the mind happens because it moves from extremes. Mind means extremes. The fight between horizontal line and vertical line, the moment you started creating fight in you, conflict in you, be very clear, your mind will never die. You will never be able to live the life. Somebody asked me just 1 hour ago, I was meeting with a group of friends. One person asked me, Swamiji, how to purify the mind? How to create good thoughts? I told him, there is no such thing as good thought. Thoughts as such, completely bad. Let me be very clear, even if you have the thought of doing a big service, it is purely out of ego. It is purely out of ego. Thoughts as such is bad. If compassion happens to you out of no mind state, thoughtless energy, only that can be pure. even your idea, even your thoughts to do service will never do any good to the world. Be very clear. Small story. There was a school. The tradition of that school is every day scout boys have to stand up and report to the scout teacher some good deed which they did in their life that day. Every day they are supposed to do some one good deed and report to the teacher. That day three scout boys stood up and they said, "Sir, we helped an old lady to cross the road. She was very old, elderly lady. We helped her to cross the road. The teacher was surprised. He said, "For one lady to cross the road, three persons are not necessary." "Why? Why three persons? You don't need three persons to make one lady to cross the road." They said, "No, sir. We need three persons because she doesn't want to cross the road." Whenever you try to do service out of your mind, you only create trouble for others. Let it be very clear. All services done out of mind only creates more and more trouble for you and others. Any thought, it creates conflicts in you and in others. The pure thoughtless space or mindless space, the energy only can give good to you and to others. Purifying the mind is simply impossible. Try your best. Of course, most of you must be trying by so many methods. I have seen people constantly repeating some mantra, some sacred words, Rama, Rama, Krishna, Krishna, something. Constantly they will be repeating, counting their beats. Why do you think people constantly repeat, count their beats, repeat some names, repeat some mantra? They are afraid of their mind. If they relax for 2 minutes, what all will come out of them, they don't know. They are sitting on a volcano. That is why constantly they engage themselves. And I tell you, these so-called people who have chosen the so-called spiritual life can never relax. At least a person who has chosen the material life can relax. But a person who has chosen the spiritual life can never relax. They will be forcing themselves to do something. In many Indian houses I have seen, they will start the habit of daily worship. At some day they would have done some worship, they would have felt really peaceful. The moment you feel the peace, immediately the greed starts. I should have the same peace every day. What to do? Then do the same puja. Do the same worship. After 1 week you can see they will be waiting when to finish the worship and come out of the room. And they will never go into that room again after the worship is done. I have seen people, they will start chanting these holy names, 1008 names or 108 names. After 2 minutes, the first thing they will do is they will see the number. What number? They are running. Are they running around 100 or 200 or 300? The moment you choose something, you create hell for you. All choices, the moment you choose, there is nothing can be done. Nobody can save you. At least the people who have chosen the material life, they will only be restless. And they will always have the guilt. I have chosen it. I am suffering. But the people who have chosen the so-called spiritual life, they will not even know the reason why they are suffering. Why? they are suffering. Constantly repeating something, trying to remember something, trying to chant some name, all these things are methods to suppress you, to suppress your consciousness. They can neither help you nor they will liberate you. At the most, they can give you more and more trouble, that's all. See, the people who are repeating names, whatever God it may be, see the people who are repeating names, 30, 40 years they will be repeating. They will be repeating, and but their mind can never achieve the purity. They will never be pure because they are suppressing. Suppressing cannot lead you to transformation. Suppression cannot lead you to transformation. Let you be very clear. Purity can happen not by suppressing the mind, but only by dropping the mind. Purity can happen to your being by dropping the mind, not by suppressing the mind. When you choose a spiritual life, you are suppressing the material life. When you choose a material life, you are suppressing the spiritual life. That is why whoever has chosen material life, they are always running behind some gurus, some master, some meditation, some program, some spirituality. And whoever has chosen the so-called spiritual life, the so-called spiritual life means the religious life, ringing bell, doing puja, this type of priests, they will always be running behind rich people. People who have chosen the material life, they will always be running behind spiritual people. People who have chosen the so-called spiritual life, they will always be running behind rich people, material people. Because you do not know what you are missing. Constantly, the other part of your mind will be creating trouble for you. If you have chosen the material life, you will always have the feeling that you are missing something. You are missing something. You are not complete. You don't feel the fulfillment. You think maybe the other shore is more green. And if you have chosen the so-called spiritual life, again you have the feeling maybe the other shore is green. As long as you have mind, be very clear, your life is suffering. As long as you have mind, life is suffering. You cannot purify your mind. Either you can have it or drop it, that's all. It's like garbage. There is no good garbage or bad garbage. There is no good garbage or bad garbage. It's a garbage. Either you have or drop. Your mind is nothing but pure, I can't say pure, impure garbage. It's nothing but garbage. Constantly you are trying to move from this side to that side. You cannot exist. Your mind cannot exist if you accept the life as it is, even for a single moment. See, here I am telling you a simple, straightforward technique. Before leaving this hall, you can become enlightened. Before leaving this hall, you can realize the truth. Before leaving this hall, you can experience the truth which I experienced. We always tell people, scientist is a person who creates a formula to reproduce the intellectual understanding which he had. For example, Newton. Newton saw apple falling. He had some intellectual understanding. Immediately he created a formula to reproduce the same understanding so that everybody can understand what he understood. He created a formula, theory of gravity, to reproduce the understanding in our minds. Scientist is a person who creates a formula to reproduce the intellectual understanding in our minds. mystic, master is a person who creates a formula to reproduce the same experience which happened in him. Now I am giving you the formula to reproduce the same experience which happened in me. Accept your body, your mind as it is. Accept your life as it is. Just for a moment. Just for one moment. If you accept your body, mind and life as it is, suddenly you will see that your mind is not working. Because your mind has no goals. As long as you want to develop, as long as you have dilemma, your mind will be active. You will be working. You will be traveling towards the hell. Be very clear. All traveling is traveling towards hell. All movement is movement towards hell. You don't need to move towards heaven. Just be. You are already in heaven. There is nothing else needs to be done. Constantly when you are moving, constantly when you are running, you are moving towards the hell. Any movement is a choice. Because of your decision, because you choose, you are moving. If you can give a small break to your mind, suddenly you will see whatever you think as material life or spiritual life, they are not contradicting each other. They are complementing each other. As long as you have an idea about material life, even before living the material life, you will have the problem. As long as you have the idea about spiritual life, even before you start the spiritual life, you have the guilt. Let it be very clear, your ideas about material life is not material life. Your ideas about spiritual life is not a spiritual life. Both are just your ideas. If you live your life with ideas, it is purely material life. Ideas are matter. Ideas are from mind. If you live your life just with the flow, you are living a spiritual life. Spiritual life or material life are not related to the status in which you are living. It is directly related to the state of mind in which you are living. Do not work on the status. People come and ask me, Swamiji, should we renounce our life to become spiritual? I always tell them, just renounce what you don't have. There is no need to renounce what you have. There is no need to renounce what you have. Live with whatever you have. Renounce what you don't have. There are so many things which you don't have, but with which you are living. Your fears, your worries, your complexities, your problems, your fantasies. They are all not there in your life, but you are living with them. If you just renounce what you don't have, but with which you are living, you are trying to live, that is enough. There is no need to renounce what you have. Just live with what you have and renounce what you don't have. I always tell people, 99% of your worries never become true, never come true. Whatever 1% comes true is always good for you. But constantly you are living with worries. Your life starts, moves, ends in worrying. Constantly your mind is kept alive because of your dilemmas and conflicts. Conflicts and dilemmas are only the feeding source for your mind. Your mind is alive because of your conflicts, because you create contradiction. First thing, Buddha says, desire is the reason for suffering. Drop it. Immediately you create one more desire to drop all the desires. Instead of understanding the truth and realizing it, experiencing it, you create one more desire. I should drop all the desires. The moment you created one more desire, the problem started. The next thing, I should drop all desires. What should I do? Then you try to do something. Whatever you try to do to drop desires, naturally it will lead to one more desire. Instead of understanding, you start creating theories. When you start creating theories, you miss spirituality. You create concepts about spiritual life. People again and again ask me, how to be desireless? How to be pure? Be very clear. You can never be pure. You can never be desireless if you try to be. If you try to be, then what should we do? Move with your mind. Let it go. Let it move. Sometimes you will feel like continuously working. Sometimes you will feel like completely resting. Sometimes you will feel like not doing anything. Sometimes you will feel like doing so many things. Whether you are feeling to do something or to rest, be very clear. It is just mood. It is mood. The big problem is you respect your thoughts too much. You give too much of respect to your thoughts. And you have so many prejudices about your thoughts, about your mind. Just a simple story. Understand, try to understand this simple story. That will give you deep understanding how your mind works and how you move. Three brothers, by very nature, all three don't get along well. Of course, brothers and sisters cannot live peacefully. Especially if you are living together, it is simply impossible. Three brothers, they are from the family of fishermen. Every day morning they go for fishing, come back, and once they come back from fishing, go to the arak shop and fill themselves. Morning they will float in the ocean, evening they will float in the arak. They drink. This is the lifestyle. One night, after drinking, I think this became too much. All the three fell on the same place. There in the shop. Early morning, elder brother is somehow managed to open his eyes, call both the brothers, come, it is time, let's go to the ocean, let's go to the sea, it's time for our routine. All three of them slowly started moving out of the shop. After 10-15 feet, all three of them felt they have come to the ocean. They just sat in the road, main road, and started fishing. One is sincerely rowing the boat. The other two are spreading their net and picking up the fish. The whole thing is happening in the main road itself. Suddenly there appeared a policeman He saw the whole scene and understood what is going on. He gave a big blow to the elder brother and shouted at him, "Just move from this place. Take both of your brothers from here. Otherwise, all three of you will go to the jail. Don't do all this nonsense in the main road. It is time you go to your home." The brother was able to understand something. Something is wrong. He has not completely understood what is going on around him. He understood there is something wrong. Next thing he understood, he has to take both his brothers from this place immediately. The moment he thought he should take his brothers from that place immediately, he started rowing fast. He started rowing. When you don't understand the very base or the root, whatever efforts you make will be only creating more and more troubles. First of all, he didn't understand where he is, what he is doing. He is not able to understand the very base. When he doesn't understand, when he is not able to understand the base, whatever efforts, whatever he tries to do, he will be only creating more and more problem. He will not be able to solve the problem. Same way, when you don't understand the root, whatever decisions you are making will be only creating more and more trouble for yourself and for others. As long as you have conflict between this material life and spiritual life, be very clear, you neither understood material life nor understood spiritual life. By your very nature, by the very existence, you are pure space which is beyond material life or spiritual life. That's what I tell by the word unclutched. By your very nature, you are unclutched. By your very nature, you are free. The idea of material life or the idea of spiritual life, both are bondage. Both takes away your freedom. By your very nature, you are liberated. You are completely liberated, free being. Understand this one example. The moment you decided to stand up, you renounced the thought to sit. The moment you decided to drink a glass of water, you renounced the thought of standing. The moment you decide to walk, you renounced the thought of listening to the discourse. The moment you decide to get into the car, you renounced the thought of sitting here or standing. Constantly, you are announcing your thoughts. People ask me, "Swamiji, sometimes I am not able to control my mind. There are some desires which makes my life hell. But I am not able to drop that desire. How can I drop the desires?" I tell them, please try to hold on to that desire continuously. Try your best. Let it be very clear, you cannot hold on to any desire. The moment you decide to walk, the moment you decide to have a glass of water, whatever desires you might have heard, you renounce that. Unless you renounce that desire, you cannot have the next thought to have a glass of water. Every moment, you are constantly renouncing your thoughts. You are constantly having new desires, new thoughts. The moment you have some fear, you renounced all your griefs. The moment you have some grief, you renounced all your fears. Constantly you are renouncing. When you don't understand that constantly you are renouncing, you try to bring back your memory. You try to bring back your thoughts, your desire to have a big house and the desire to have a glass of water. Both of them are equally intense in your inner space. But because of your prejudice, your conditioning, you think the desire to have a house is a big desire and desire to have a glass of water is a small desire. Let it be very clear, in your inner space, both of them are one and the same. The moment you have the desire to have a glass of water, you renounce the desire to have a house. Unless that desire moves away, this desire cannot come. Constantly, thoughts are changing in you. Constantly, the new desires are appearing in you. Constantly, you are moving. In your inner space, the desire to have a glass of water or the desire to have a big car, both are equally intense. Only in a superficial level, in the social level, because of your conditioning, you start believing desire to have a big car, desire to have a house is big desire. You can't renounce that. Desire to have a cup of tea or a glass of water is a small desire. The very idea, something is big desire, something is a small desire. The very idea, something is a big fear, something is a small fear. Only these ideas create hell in you. Constantly, you are renouncing. Constantly, thoughts are moving in you. One more thing. You should understand the secret of your mind. The secret about your mind is a illogical, independent, completely irresponsible, unconnected thoughts. Let it be very clear. Your thoughts are not logical. Your thoughts are not connected. Your thoughts are not completely responsible. Your thoughts are not linked logically. A simple experiment. Try to do this simple experiment. Sit with a paper and pen. Write whatever comes to your mind. Do not edit. Do not say it's a right thought, it's a wrong thought. Do not say it's a good thought, it's a bad thought. Just write down. Just write for yourself. After 10 minutes, try to read that paper. You will understand what big mad asylum is going on in you. Just try to write for 10 minutes, whatever comes. And after 10 minutes, try to read that paper. You will understand what I am saying. Your thoughts are completely irresponsible, unconnected, illogical, and independent. Let me tell you a small example. You see a dog in the street. Immediately you remember the dogs about which you are afraid, or the dogs with which you played in your young age. Your pet, the young age. Then next you will remember about your childhood. First, the moment you see the dog, you remember about your childhood pet. Then you remember about your childhood life. Then you remember about the teacher with whom you studied. Then you remember the place where the teacher used to stay. Simply just like the thoughts will move. There is no logical connection between the dog which you saw in the street and the teacher under whom you studied. Even though both of them have barked at you. There is no logical connection between the teacher, and the dog. Your thought style, your thought structure, your mind flow is completely illogical and unconnected. try your best to bring it to a line, you will never be able to do. Somehow by God's grace, you can't control your mind. If you can, long before you would have become mad. Let it be very clear. Constantly people come and ask me, Swamiji, last 30 years I am repeating some mantra, but still my mind is not concentrated. Still my mind has not become holy. The moment I stop repeating mantra, same old type of thoughts come in the mind. What to do, Swamiji? One young monk went to an elderly monk who is 90 years old. Young monk is asking, Sir, please guide me. I am haunted by bad thoughts. How long it takes to come out of these bad thoughts, to become pure, to become holy? The elderly monk said, I don't know how long it takes, but surely till 90 years you will have the same problem. I don't know how long it takes, but surely till 90 years you will have the same problem. Be very clear. Trying to control the mind, trying to suppress the mind will lead you to only more and more problems. You cannot control the mind. You cannot suppress the mind. All you can do is only one thing. Drop the mind. You can create a distance between you and the mind. All techniques, methods to control the mind or suppress the mind leads only to more and more contradiction, more and more complications, more and more difficulties. Any of you are here, if you honestly check with yourself, if you have tried to control your mind, not for 1 year or 2 years, even for 10 or 15 years, you can understand the truth behind my words. If you really tried hard to repeat some mantra, to repeat some holy name, to repeat some meditation, to repeat some technique to control your mind, to suppress your mind, you will understand the truth of what I am uttering. You will understand the truth behind these words. Let it be very clear, mind cannot be controlled. The moment you try to control, you are choosing between materialistic life and spiritual life. Mind can never be controlled. Try your best to control. It cannot be controlled. You can do only one thing. You can create distance between you and your mind. You can only drop the mind. You can only go beyond the mind. You cannot control the mind. You can see in your life, the moment you see somebody, mentally you will be thinking, I should respect this person, I should respect this person. You will be trying your best to respect that person mentally, but unconsciously one thought to disrespect him will come. The moment that thought comes, you will try to suppress your mind. No, I should not think about him like this. This is not the right way. And I should respect him. And if you want to love somebody, same way, the moment you think that you should love somebody, immediately one thought to disrespect him or hate him will come. And what you will do? No, I should not think all these things. You suppress it. You see a good food, the moment you think of eating, immediately at least one thought of fear. No, I think I should control myself. I should control my tongue. Always your mind will create some contradiction, some conflict, some problem. At 1 second, it will create something which is completely opposite of what you want to do. What you want to do. Mind exists because of these dilemmas, because of these contradictions, because of this conflict. By your very nature, you are unclutched, Constantly you are announcing the thoughts. Constantly you are giving up your thoughts. The moment the thought to drink a glass of water comes, you announce your serious desires. The moment you decide to stand up, you announce the thought of sitting. The moment you decide to get into the car, you renounce your desire for your house. You cannot stick to a single thought. Unless the next thought comes, your life cannot move. If you stop at one thought, be very clear, you are dead. You are dead. Life moves because you are constantly renouncing. Let you be very clear. Life is happening in you because you renounce. Even in your body, constantly millions of cells are dying. That is why millions of new cells are being created. Because you are ready to renounce. You are ready to renounce some part of your being. The new part is getting created when you are alive. The day you decide to stop renouncing, you will be dead. The day you decide, I will not drop any of my part, I will stop so many millions of cells dying in my life, immediately the creation of cells will stop. You will see the big death. Let it be very clear, by your very nature, you are announcing. Your mind, your thoughts, your flow, everything is getting again and again purified by your very nature. But when you start believing strongly, there are some thoughts, either guilt or fear or greed. No, I am not able to renounce them. I am not able to give them up. They are again and again coming in my mind. Your belief that you are not able to renounce them is the only problem. Nothing else is a problem. Then again, that becomes one more connection. Let you understand this single truth. It can liberate you this moment. Beautiful example, beautiful quotation from Jai Krishnamurti, a great master. Somebody goes to him and asks, "Master, my friend is having a lot of problems with sets and fantasies, can you give such solution?" Somehow, when it comes to fantasies and sex, only friends will have the problem. These guys will never have the problem. I'm surprised. Always people come and ask me, "Swamiji, my friend is asking me, he's having a lot of problem with fantasies, can you help him?" I tell them, "Please call your friend, I'll directly help him." People are afraid to put the questions.